Donald Trump Jr.'s meeting with a Russian lawyer is changing once again. Here's the latest. Donald Trump's personal attorney, Jay Sekulow, went on TV this morning and suggested the U.S. Secret Service wouldn't have let the meeting happen if the people involved were nefarious. Now the Secret Service is responding, telling us in a statement Donald Trump Jr. was not a protectee of the U.S. Secret Service in June of 2016. Thus, we would not have screened anyone he was meeting with at that time. Joining me now, CNN politics reporter Eugene Scott, national politics reporter for Real Clear Politics, Caitlin Huey Burns, and contributor for Time Magazine, Jay Newton Small. So, Eugene, we rarely get on-camera briefings. There's been this lack of press conferences. The one person who is speaking out, responding to the latest development regarding Donald Trump Jr.'s meeting there at Trump Tower, gets it wrong.
Right. It's not surprising, though, that he's getting this wrong, because he probably is getting information day by day like many people. The reality is, if we reflect on when the story first came out last week, it looks very different now. And so he's going forward to the media trying to tell us everything that he knows, and the reality is he may not know everything. And we've seen this happen before with the communications team. It's just a big problem across the board with the Trump administration and messaging.
Now, the president is tweeting today as well. I want to read what he wrote. Hillary Clinton can illegally get the questions to the debate and delete 33,000 emails, but my son Don is being scorned by the fake news media. First of all, we covered the Clinton stuff when that happened as well, thoroughly. But, you know, he can say the problem is the reporting. Let's listen to what Republican Trey Gowdy had to say about this latest situation. Remember, he is somebody who was heavily involved in the Hillary Clinton Benghazi hearings. Watch.
Someone close to the president needs to get everyone connected with that campaign in a room and say, from the time you saw Dr. Zhivago until the moment you drank vodka with a guy named Boris, you list every single one of those, and we're going to turn them over to the special counsel.
Caitlin, is this a self-inflicted wound
by
the Trump administration?
Representative Gowdy has a great point here, and it comes up over and over again. Every time the form that Jared Kushner is filling out has to be updated with more contacts, there are these questions about why didn't you just disclose all of these meetings beforehand? What's really interesting about the president attacking the media and attacking the reporting is that, you know, this is a situation in which his son released these emails that show these conversations and the setup to the conversation. So that discredits the president's argument here. And you hear from Republicans on Capitol Hill that they want to get to the bottom of this. They are interested, too, in figuring out the Russian meddling aspect of this. And this just brings it back into light. And as much as the president would like to move on, he can't. There are investigations going on led by Republicans to get to the bottom of this, which shows how significant they think it is.
Meantime, he keeps looking back, and you talked about attacking reporters and the reporting, but he's also continuing to attack his former opponent. So, Jay, what is up with the president's fixation with Hillary Clinton?
Well, it goes back to his campaign mode, right? So that's where the president's always most comfortable, is when he's rallying big crowds, when he's sort of out campaigning and glad handing. And so that was also when he was most popular, right? I mean, if you look at his poll approval ratings right now, they're pretty dismal. And so he's always looking for a straw man to strike down. And Hillary Clinton was the most convenient straw man during the campaign, obviously. And now there is no one else to blame. There's no one else to blame but himself. And he's never going to do that. He's never going to say, yeah, we were wrong. And even though clearly, from the first time we heard about this, when the Trump administration had said, no, there were no contacts with Russia, this is just ludicrous, this is a witch hunt, quote unquote, and then every day there's new contacts with Russia that comes out from various different campaign officials and from administration officials. And so, you know, you can't blame everything on Hillary Clinton. She's lost the campaign, lost the election more than 9 months ago, and you have to find somebody else, but there is no one else, really.
Guys, White House counsel Kellyanne Conway, she took a very different approach this week, trying to fight back against the theories of collusion, and she used props. Watch.
I just want to review, in case you run out of time, this is how I see it so far. This is to help all the people at home. What's the conclusion? Collusion? No, we don't have that yet. I see illusion and delusion. So just so we're clear, everyone, four words. Conclusion, collusion, no. Illusion, delusion, yes. I just thought we'd have some fun with words. Sesame's Grover word of the day, perhaps, Sean.
Now, couple that with the polling showing only 33% of Republicans believe Russia tried to influence the election compared to 80% of Democrats. Eugene, it seems like the White House and the president's messaging is working.
Well, it's working with Republicans, and I think it's very important to realize that according to the most recent Gallup poll, only about 1 in 4 Americans self-identify as Republican. So we have to remember that the majority of voters do not believe that the message that the Trump administration is putting out is accurate. And even among Republicans, it's only about 80% who still view him favorably. So it's 1 in 5 Republicans plus 3 in 4 voters as a whole. They are having a messaging issue, and I think the most important word that Kellyanne said with those flashcards was yet.
How much do you think this whole story has been a drag on the presidency at this point, almost 6 months in?
Well, certainly if you look at the legislative agenda, it's stalled right now. And the reason is that you have, you know, no political incentive for Democrats, of course, to work with this president, given those ratings. And you also have Republicans on Capitol Hill who are trying to work on things like health care reform, get through the agenda, who are also constantly bombarded with all of this information. And as much as they try to move on from it, this is kind of every shoe, another shoe drops at any given moment. What's interesting about these poll numbers, though, are that the president does have a very low approval rating. That approval rating mirrors his favorability during the campaign, which is kind of also interesting. He was unpopular during the campaign, remains so now. The number I always look at is that number among Republicans, which is still very high. Mm-hmm. He's still very popular among Republicans, which shows that he's very much speaking to his base. But we have to keep an eye on those independent voters. Right. And in those polls, as you mentioned, that number is slipping a little bit.
Jay, I'll give you the final thought.
Look, it's absolutely, as Caitlin was saying, that the Congress is I think half and half. So I've heard from leadership that they actually didn't mind the distraction this week because they're trying to work behind the scenes to get health care done. And with all the media's attention focused on Don Jr. and on Russia, it kind of took some of the pressure off and, you know, some of the town hall meetings and some of those things. At the same time, it also handicaps the president's leverage with senators when he's calling them up from Bedminster saying, you really need to vote for this. He doesn't have the same sort of political juice that he would have if he didn't have this investigation sort of hanging over his head. And so he doesn't have a lot of the tools that presidents usually have to coerce senators and members of Congress to vote for things and that they'd like them to vote for. So it can be both sort of a blessing and a curse at the same time.
Jay Newton-Small, Caitlin Huey-Burns, and Eugene Scott. Great discussion. Thanks, guys.